Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
So I'd like to introduce our panelists. And we're going to start here with Olga on my left. So Olga Solomon is a multidisciplinary social science researcher with training in applied linguistics, linguistic anthropology, and clinical psychology. Her scholarship on neurodiverse children and their families provides a wide theoretical and methodological base to address complex research questions relevant to pediatric and related research. Thanks for being a part of this, Olga. And then to my far left, this is Elyn Saks. Elyn Saks is Orrin B. Evans Distinguished Professor of Law, Psychology, and Psychiatry, and the Behavioral Sciences at USC's Gould School of Law. Founder and Faculty Director of the Saks Institute for Mental Health Law, Policy, and Ethics. Adjunct Professor of Psychiatry at the University of California, San Diego. School of Medicine and faculty at USC's Keck School of Medicine and the New Center for Psychoanalysis. Professor Saks received her JD from Yale Law School and a PhD in psychoanalytic science from the New Center for Psychoanalysis. She was also awarded an honorary Doctor of Laws degree from Pepperdine University and an honorary Doctor of Humane Letters from William James College. Elyn Saks writes extensively in the area of law and mental health, having published 5 books and more than 60 articles and book chapters. Her memoir, The Center Cannot Hold, My Journey Through Madness, describes her struggles with schizophrenia and her managing to craft a good life for herself in the face of a dire prognosis. She's won numerous honors, including a 2009 John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Fellowship, the so-called Genius Grant, and the Schizophrenia International Research Society 2023 President's Award for her research, advocacy, and work to destigmatize severe mental illness. Her TED Talk has garnered over 6 million views. And then joining us via Zoom, we have Sneha Mathur. So Sneha Mathur is a faculty member in the psychology department at USC, where she teaches master's level courses in applied behavior analysis and undergraduate courses related to autism and neurodiversity. Sneha considers herself an ally to the disability and autism communities. She co-wrote the book, Understanding the Lived Experiences of Autistic Adults with Autistic Adult Adam Paul Valerius. What makes Sneha's research, teaching, and consulting unique is her expertise in 2 very distinct areas, applied behavior analysis and disability studies. She's able to lay out behaviorally supported practices within a caring social model context. Ultimately, Sneha's work centers on increasing the quality of life for individuals with autism, and her future-focused approach allows her to help individuals build long-term success. So welcome all panelists. So before we get started with questions, all of the panelists have prepared something to share with you all from their work. So we'll start with Sneha, since she's gonna be sharing a video.
Sure, and thank you everyone for allowing me to Zoom in today since I wasn't feeling well. I appreciate still getting the opportunity to participate. So in our book, Adam and I co-wrote, I prefer that Adam read his own passage because I think it's a lot more powerful to hear directly from him. And so in this video, you will hear Adam read a passage about his lived experience.
On Friday, December 10th, 1999, I left my high school an hour early because I was being teased by the other students. I tried to go home, but I forgot my keys, so I was locked out. My parents were home but did not let me in the house until I attempted to break the door down, with a sledgehammer. Once they let me into the house, there was an hour-long shouting match. Then they called the police because they felt that I was a threat. I was no threat. If they had just opened the door when I rang the bell, I would never have grabbed the sledgehammer. The police blocked the street, making me look like a terrorist. My dad wanted me arrested and sent to juvenile hall. My mom wanted me hospitalized. My parents and the police argued for an hour, and then the police decided to take me to the hospital. I was standing there, not a part of the conversation. Every time I tried to break into the conversation, I was shouted down. It was during this hospital stay that the psychiatrist at the hospital decided I needed long-term care at a facility called the Buckeye Ranch. I was very angry that I was being taken to a place where I would be locked up. When I got there, I remember thinking it looked like a jail because there were bars around the buildings and the small room felt like a jail cell. That ended up being my home for the next 94 days. My name is Adam Paul Valerius, and this is my story. I get told that I am an inspiration and I bring hope to mental health consumers, parents, and autism parents. What I hope to achieve by writing this book is to spread that same hope to a broader range of people who I may never meet face to face. When I tell some people what I'm doing with my life, they admit they didn't think someone with this condition could do most of this because of the media stereotypes and portrayals of autism. I want to break the stereotypes. I am writing this book with Sneha, who to me represents an autism advocate. Sneha approached me to write this book to help understand the needs of autistic folks like me as we transition to adulthood. Sneha asked me to define adulthood so that we could use my definition in this book. To me, adulthood is freedom and independence, like you're finally in control of your own life instead of someone else controlling your life for you. Responsibilities come with the freedom and independence, but adulthood is being able to handle those responsibilities. Independence is like getting to see the doctor without your parents right there, having a bank account they don't have access to, paying your own rent and bills. Opportunities to meet others with my diagnosis may have existed before my adulthood, but I do not recall seeking or taking them. There were other kids at my school diagnosed elsewhere on the autism spectrum, but I was nothing like them. I didn't really want to discuss my diagnosis until adulthood when I started living my all-play, no-work lifestyle that I believe most people in Orange County, California despise me for. Now I want to educate people on how difficult it actually is for someone with autism to make money and be accepted in the neurotypical mainstream workplace and society. I use the term neurotypical to refer to people who are not diagnosed with autism spectrum disorders. I can't even describe me the person. There are just no words. But if there's one thing I could tell the world about myself, it would be that I am my own brand of eccentric. Sneha helped me put my story into words, and I am proud of my story and my life.
Thank you, Sneha and Adam.
Sure.
So maybe next we'll hear from Olga.
I hope it's not going to be too long. I wanted to read from just an article I wrote actually 12 years ago or 13 for Annual Review of Anthropology. And it talks about a story that Oliver Sacks has written called The Twins. So I'll just read that segment. So Sacks reports on his experience with autistic twins, John and Michael, at the state hospital. The twins were calendar-calculating savants, and their story demonstrates how difference in cognition and perception, in sense and the senses, becomes highly consequential for the life course of autistic individuals. When Saks first met them, the twins were in their late 20s and had been institutionalized since childhood. Back then, that's what was going on mostly in this country. They communicated with each other by a conversational exchange of prime numbers, a communion based on their shared aesthetic appreciation of a simultaneously perceived and contemplated, mutually visible and harmonious numerical landscape. So, quoting Saks, they were seated in a corner together with a mysterious secret smile on their faces, enjoying the strange pleasure and peace they now seem to have. They seem to be locked in a singular, purely numerical universe. John would say a number, a six-figure number. Michael would catch the number, nod, smile, and seem to savor it. Then he in turn would say another six-figure number, and now it was John who received and appreciated it richly. They looked at first like two connoisseurs wine tasting, sharing rare tastes, rare appreciations. Such visualization, Saks proposes, may be algorithms that are organized not algebraically but spatially, as trees, spirals, architectures, thoughtscapes. When Saks joined the twins in his conversation, offering his own prime number, they looked surprised, then joyful, then moved slightly apart to make space for their new conversational partner. They welcomed him into their social numerical universe. 10 years later, they're separated, quote unquote, for their own good, to force them out of this universe and their unhealthy, quote unquote, unhealthy communication together. They now live apart in halfway houses, do manual jobs under close supervision, and take public transportation if directed and given a bus token. They keep themselves presentable and clean. The semblance of normalcy and independence comes at a high price. Bereft of each other, they lose their numeral world and with it the joy, the personal and emotional center, the sense of their lives. The story ends with Saks musing that this loss is never mentioned in the twins' charts and never recognized. The psychiatrists and others who could have done so are syntactically, euphemistically absent in the story, indexed in passive constructions as invisible forces. It was felt that the twins should be separated. They were separated, moved to halfway houses. They are always being hurried and jostled from one job to another. This is considered a small price to pay. Saks asked, what are we supposed to think about such a curious cure? And the reason I wanted to read this today is the idea that what we think of neurodiversity comes with a lot of understandings of what is desirable and what is required and what does a good life look like? Does a good life look like being, you know, forced to separate the twins and kind of make them participate in the neuronormative world and insist kind of the violence of that? I'm very interested in my work in how environments either make something possible or they don't. They rob people of possibilities. And I really feel that work that I do at the USC University Center for Excellence in Developmental Disabilities, this is kind of the philosophy with which we operate, which is really not to try to squeeze everybody into a box and make them, you know, fit there pretty much or not, but really to try create environments in which, you know, children or youth or adults with autism can flourish really on their own terms, you know, to tell us what it is that they need, because it's actually not so hard to listen. And I really feel that the neurodiversity movement or philosophy is really opening the doors to this kind of a discussion, which was not really possible even 10 years ago. So, and I can't believe that Ellen was not the one speaking first, but okay. She has her own. Okay, well, thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm honored and delighted to be here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to read a few passages from my book, and then I'm going to talk about the neurodiversity issues. Hard to see here. So it's 10 o'clock on a Friday night. I'm sitting with my two classmates at the Yale Law School Library. They aren't too happy about being here. It's the weekend, after all. There are plenty of other things that we could be doing. But I'm determined that we hold our small group meeting. We have a memo assignment. We have to do it, to finish it, have to produce it, have to... Wait a minute. No, wait. Memos or visitations, I announce. They make certain points. The points are on your head. Have you killed anyone? My study partners look at me as if they or I have been splashed with ice water. This is a joke, right? Asked one of them. What are you talking about, Ellen? Asked the other. Oh, the usual. Heaven and hell. Who's what? What's who? Hey, I say, leaping out of my chair. Let's go out on the roof. I practically sprint to the nearest large window, climb through it, and step out onto the roof, followed a few moments later by my reluctant partners in crime. This is the real me, I announce, my arms waving above my head. Come to the Florida lemon tree. Come to the Florida sunshine bush, where they make lemons, where there are demons. Hey, what's the matter with you guys? You're frightening me, one of them said. A few uncertain moments later, I'm going back inside. And hey, wait a minute, they're scrambling back through the window. Why are you going back in, I ask, but they're already inside and I'm alone. A few moments later, somewhat reluctantly, I climb back through the window too. Once we're all seated around the table again, I carefully stack my textbooks into a small tower, then rearrange my note pages. Then I rearrange them again. I can see the problem, but I can't see its solution. This is very worrisome. I don't know if you're having the same experience I am of words jumping around the page, as I say. I think someone's infiltrated my copies of the cases. We've got a case of joint. I don't believe in joints, but they do hold your body together. I glance up from my paper to see my two colleagues staring at me. I have to go, says one. Me too, says the other. They seem nervous as they hurriedly pack up their stuff and leave, with a vague promise about catching up with me later and working on the memo then. I hide in the stacks until well after midnight, sitting on the floor, muttering to myself. It grows quiet. The lights are being turned off. Frightened, I believe being locked in, I finally scurry out, checking through the shadowy library so as not to be seen by any security people. It's dark outside. I don't like the way it feels to walk back to my dorm. And once there, I can't sleep anymore, and mass murders that I will be responsible for go through my mind. I have to work. I cannot work. I cannot think. The next day, I'm in a panic and hurry to Professor N, pleading for an extension. The memo materials have been infiltrated, I tell him. I'm jumping around. I used to be good at the broad jump because I'm tall. I fall. People put things in and then say it's my fault. I used to be God, but I got demoted. I begin to sing my little Florida juice jingle, twisting around his office, my arms thrust out like bird wings. So that was the opening of my book. The Center Cannot Hold. Sorry. My Journey Through Madness. Actually, when I decided to do the book, I consulted a guy named Rebel Steiner, who's an entertainment lawyer, and I asked him if he remembered that scene on the roof of the Yale Law School, and he looked at me and he said, "How could I forget?" I'm going to talk a little about the session, which is, the title is Neurodiversity, Lived Experience, Advocacy, and Allyship. So I would like to thank everybody here today. It touches me that so many folks want to be allies to those of us with lived experience. And your presence and your allyship are deeply meaningful to me. So defining and conceptualizing neurodiversity, what does it mean to you and what is its your significance in your work? I focus on the diversity aspect of neurodiversity. What I mean is that in my case, although I have lived experience with schizophrenia, it's important to be mindful that today people speak in the plural about schizophrenias rather than as if there is a single, illness. Much like cancer, there are many different cancers that people experience very differently. So I always want to be mindful that my way of experiencing schizophrenia may be unique to me. In terms of its significance to my work, my lived experience of serious mental illness has always been a driving force behind my work, but not always overtly so. For example, I was not, quote, out when I was in law school. And let me tell you a story that helps explain why I was not yet out. This was at Yale Law School. I decided to write an article for the Law Journal on the use of mechanical restraints in psychiatric hospitals. I approached a law school faculty member who was a psychiatrist and a psychoanalyst and explained my project to him without giving any of my personal history. I said that I believed that mechanical restraints would be painful and degrading. His response to me was, "You don't understand, Ellen. These people are psychotic. They aren't like you and me. They wouldn't experience restraints the way we would." I didn't have the courage to tell him in that moment that these people are just like you and me, and that's exactly how we would experience restraints. It was only by, quote, othering me and people with lived experience of mental illness that he could accept for us what he would never accept for himself or his family or loved ones. So centering of the first person perspective and lived experience. All of my work centers first person perspectives and narratives, people sharing their stories and experiences from their own perspective and letting that guide the research and the narrative. Why did I choose to do this, and how do I think it changes or adds to the conversation about neurodiversity? Well, my response is pretty straightforward. The research tells us that stories are what most move people. Putting a human face on the lived experience of serious mental illness, rather than making intellectual arguments, is what changes minds, brings understanding, and reduces stigma. That's why I chose to tell my story. My goal in telling my story is to bring hope to those with schizophrenia and understanding to those who don't have lived experience. I'll share a brief anecdote about the dangers of stigma. I went to the emergency room with a subarachnoid hemorrhage, a brain bleed. I was confused and incoherent. At that time, about 50% of people with subarachnoid hemorrhages died from it within a few days. I'm glad I didn't know that statistic, or I would have had a heart attack. The ER folks learned about my psychiatric history, and then a predictable disaster occurred. They believed I was simply having a psychotic episode. They sent me home. I went back the next day at the frantic urging of friends who, this time, accompanied me to the ER. They were able to convince the doctors that something was very different. The ER ran some simple tests, and they admitted me to the hospital. Again, I was having a subarachnoid hemorrhage, a brain bleed. I was very lucky to have those friends with me. Otherwise, I imagine I would once again have been told to take more of my medication and then be sent home. How do you manage the complexities of understanding and communicating another person's experience, perspective, and personal experiences? I want to be very careful here. I can't speak for anyone else, and I always begin with the assumption that a person with lived experience of mental health disorder is his or her own best spokesperson. So for me, The starting point here is to support other folks as they give voice to their own experiences and to support them in articulating their needs and desires and not to speak for them.
Elyn, can we thank you so much for sharing those insights and for all of you for sharing your work. And I wonder, I'm curious also from the other panelists, your thoughts. You know, Elyn shared such a great kind of introduction to neurodiversity and what this means for your work and what this means to you. And I'm curious also for Olga and Sneha, how would you define neurodiversity? All of you kind of speak to neurodiversity in different ways in your work. So curious how this might align or also be different. So what does neurodiversity mean to you and what does it mean for your work?
Yeah, so for me, I've noticed that the term neurodiversity has been thrown around a lot in the last decade or so, but it seems like people are using that term interchangeably and meaning different things by them. So what I usually like to do when I'm talking about neurodiversity is separate these concepts into three categories. One, neurodiversity. Neurodiversity in and of itself is just a simple biological fact that humans have a diversity of minds, of behaviors, and of ways of understanding the world. They have neurocognitive variations that in and of itself is not a negative connotation, and it does not have to imply medical pathology. It's just a difference in a way of experiencing the world. And this concept was created by neurodiverse individuals. Then we have the neurodiversity paradigm, which is a more academic way of understanding and applying this concept, this fact of neurodiversity. And so a lot of my work, especially in the book with Adam and myself, has revolved around the neurodiversity paradigm, which has been influenced by many disciplines, including sociology, critical psychology, critical medical humanities, disability studies, and critical autism studies. And so the purpose and the goal of the neurodiversity paradigm is to approach autism and other neurodivergencies as a form of a simple divergence, not a deficit that needs to be fixed, but rather a divergence that needs to be understood. Then you have the neurodiversity movement, which has been gaining a lot of traction in the media over the last few years. And what the neurodiversity movement is a social justice movement that basically compares differences in neurocognitive communication to differences in cultural approaches to communication. So the neurodiversity movement seeks civil rights, equality, respect, and full societal inclusion for the neurodivergent folks. So in relation to the work that I do, which is largely with autistic folks, using the neurodiversity paradigm, you can think of autism as a combination of neurological differences combined with societal oppression, because these differences are perceived as deficits to be fixed rather than just to be understood and appreciated.
Thank you. Olga, what do you think?
Sure. So I absolutely agree, you know, with what Sneha just articulated. But I think that I also would like to comment on what Elyn just shared, you know, her experience in the emergency room. And I think that, you know, neurodiversity also means environmental kind of attunement to the person's experience. And that, unfortunately, I think is pretty pretty behind currently. So what Elyn has been, you know, was describing in the clinical literature is called diagnostic overshadowing. And unfortunately, it happens to kids on the spectrum quite a lot, where they end up in an emergency room with a tooth abscess, and they're told to go home, and nobody really checks out what's really going on, you know, kind of physically, but everybody assumes that they're just having a bad day, and they're sent home, and sometimes, you know, to people's horror, they realize that this person has had the tooth abscess for the last, ungodly time. And so there is a lot of this kind of assumption that the main diagnosis is the governing kind of principle of your behavior. And that, from a clinical perspective, has very harmful consequences. So, the idea that when, neurodiversity cannot stay at the ideological level, it has to have practical, consequences in the way to how, we restructure our environments in a way that makes it possible for everyone to be safe and healthy and seen and acknowledged and, receive, healthcare that they need and sometimes, desperately need. So kind of the environmental piece to me is very important and frankly intriguing. I was one of the first brave people who back in 2006 documented on video, so you couldn't argue that didn't happen, interactions of kids on the spectrum with therapy dogs and the remarkable social ability that this interaction with these very, safe, sweet, very reciprocal, dogs provided for these kids. And, children who, in the IEPs, I remember there was one girl in her IEP, it was said something like she couldn't do anything for more than 5 minutes. She was, interacting with this very beautiful white Australian shepherd for 2 hours straight. And in fact, we had to leave and probably would have interacted more. And so this idea, that really kind of started me thinking that how easy it is to put a dog in the middle of a social interaction with the siblings and let this child who has always been kind of therapized and, treated and trained and, controlled and somehow regulated, to let this child have the experience of interacting with an animal that's not judging, that's really kind of doing what she understands, the dog, what this kid needs and wants. And it seemed to be miraculous, but, scientifically, you can really show that reciprocal behavior happens on both sides. It's not just one person who is supposed to be reciprocal. It's two entities, right, in an interaction. And so when kids on the spectrum have this experience of reciprocal interaction, something, probably that could have happened, from the beginning really happens. And so these kind of moments and also, frankly, just experiences and environments really hold a lot of analytic and frankly existential interest for me, because it feels like the way we understand conditions like schizophrenia, like autism, in very, very kind of important ways organizes people's lives. And I feel like that's where, my work kind of comes in, with really understanding what those environments should look like and how we should adapt them in order to really have true neurodiversity in our world. So
this reminds me of the double empathy problem, which is that, in regards to autism, let's say oftentimes the autistic person's behavior is seen as a deficit that needs to be changed, whereas the double empathy problem reconceptualizes the problem as both neurotypical and neurodiverse people need to understand each other's behaviors. The burden of change should not be on the autistic person. It's just as much our responsibility to change the way that we're doing things to create more inclusive and welcoming communities and environments.
Yeah, thank you so much. And I think, when we talk about the neurodiversity paradigm and the social model of disability, we speak about environments and contexts being disabling. And these are such good examples of, Elyn sharing your story of being in the emergency room and the people around you being what's disabling. And Olga, on the other side, that a shift in the social partner and the reciprocity can make such a big impact. So thank you all for sharing. And my next question was, and Elyn, you spoke to this already with your discussion of why you shared your story and the importance of sharing lived experience. So I'm curious just to hear from you all more about this. All of your work really centers lived experience and the lived experience of neurodivergent individuals. Some speaking their story for themselves, others sharing their story in a way that makes sense to them and how they express themselves. So I'm curious how, why have you focused on this in your writings, in your research? And the second piece is just the complexities, particularly Olga and Sneha, for communicating another person's and other people's perspectives, and how do you manage those complexities?
Yeah, I would like to start with an adage, which is nothing about us without us. So at the Saks Institute over at the law school, people with lived experience are involved in every aspect of our work. It's absolutely essential that folks with lived experience are part of developing and implementing any policy that applies to them. So for healthcare providers, for educators, for researchers, begin at the beginning. Speak to people with lived experience and ask them what they need. Hearing their voices, listening to their voices, is the most affirming stance you can take.
Yes, I absolutely agree. Nothing about us without us is the rallying cry of the social model of disability. And I think, so for me, when you heard Adam reading his passage of his lived experience in traditional academic material, that might have been part of an interview I did with him, and then I took what he said and summarized it, and that would not give anywhere near the impact of hearing Adam's story directly from Adam. And so for us, it was very, very important that Adam's story was in his voice, not changed by my voice. And so in our book, we have three parts, and part two is completely Adam's voice and his story. Parts one and parts three are more academic, more analytic, more applicable. How do you use this information? But I think that centering folks' lived experiences has not traditionally been done in academia, but it's nice to see it being done more and more. I do want to note that when seeking out lived experiences, we have to remember that it is not the neurodivergent person's responsibility to teach us how to be better clinicians and teachers. So it's our responsibility to seek out their guidance, to compensate them for their time, to ask them to share their stories with us and things like that. But then it's our responsibility to take that information and, as co-collaborators, create better practices without that burden falling on the neurodivergent person.
And just to kind of continue this line of, you know, conversation, I think that there is a, in my view, kind of a hopeful development in academia and hopefully in the kind of larger workforce environment, that it's not just talking to, you know, neurodiverse individuals and asking them questions about their experience that really needs to happen, but having coworkers who are, you know, who hold paid positions just like neurotypical people in the workplace, you know, that they're not just like the special entity that somebody consults with in order to, you know, for something to happen, but really honestly kind of mean it and make, you know, maybe necessary adaptations, create, you know, kind of a vision of employment that just prioritizes neurodiversity as a necessary component of our, you know, workplaces, and not, you know, in, you know, manual jobs like traditionally has happened, or, you know, low-skill jobs, but really, you know, just make the workplace, you know, open and just, you know, completely inclusive in a way of neurodiverse, you know, individuals. And, you know, we're working in this direction. We just started, you know, kind of really exciting projects on with in collaboration with the USC Center for Advanced Manufacturing, which is part of the Viterbi School of Engineering, with Dr. Satyendra Gupta and his team, on training young adults on the autism spectrum in robotics programming. And we have been developing curriculum, and our USC USAID's director, Dr. Yin, now has a robotic arm in his office. And so we do our pilot, and my colleague Wesley Witherspoon right here, just last Wednesday, you know, worked with that robotic arm to an amazing success. I have an electrical engineering degree from the Soviet Union from a very, very long time ago. And every single person that we asked to use that arm did better than I did. And there were four people. Wesley was one of them. So I was very humbled by this idea that, you know, they definitely out, you know, they did enormously better than I did. And so... So, you know, things like that where you, you know, I want to say, I know it's, I'm sounding a little sarcastic and kind of facetious, but it's not rocket science. You know, we really should have practical training applications that acknowledge skills that, you know, some, you know, individuals would have. You know, they actually have advantages often. You know, people in like Beth Hamlin in England back in the 1980s was writing about, you know, the really cognitive advantages that people on the autism spectrum have with certain tasks, you know, certain cognitive tasks. And I think that, you know, just like everybody, right, we all have talents and we all have, you know, weaknesses. And just to optimize, you know, again, the training environments in which those talents could get developed, because it doesn't happen automatically. And in fact, we know that environments are usually suppressing these talents when, you know, they're not acknowledged correctly. And then I also want to say, we actually just had a discussion with, you know, with Dr. Ian at the office on Wednesday. The other thing I feel is important about neurodiversity is this idea that we really need to stop interpreting competence based upon social behavior. Because it feels that if people are not looking at us the way that, you know, neuronormatively we think they should, or if they're not socially orienting to us in some neuronormative way, somehow down this road, there is a huge harm about thinking that this person somehow is not as cognitively gifted as people who do these, you know, more reciprocal behaviors. So I really think that there is such a problematic attachment of how we interpret ability based upon social behavior, that I think that that's the first thing that needs to happen in all environments, frankly, at schools and in, you know, like how many times the kids are told, oh, you know, you have to, you know, look here, right? Or like you have to, you know, attend a certain way, and the attending is not just, you know, sensory attending, but also kind of, you know, a performance, right? The performance of attending. And that when that performance of attending doesn't somehow happen in ways that people expect, then the whole thing is, you know, getting completely discarded. And I think that there is a huge, first of all, lost opportunity, but also harm lies in that. So that's my thinking about that. So.
To piggyback off of that, Olga, you know, there's the point of that, you know, everyone needs supports in life, whether you're neurodivergent or neurotypical, but when it's the neurotypical folks who are the ones deciding which supports neurodivergent people need, that leads to problems. How can you speak for a population, for a whole population's needs, when you have never experienced those needs? So something I like to ask myself and my supervisees is, are we working on this specific goal or specific need because it's increasing the neurodivergent person's quality of life? Or are we working on these perceived needs because it makes the neurotypical person's life easier or the neurotypical person feel less awkward? And this is where, like you said, the, you know, the co-collaboration and the strengths-based approach rather than a deficit-based approach comes in. I really like what you said also about companies and employers needing to implement actual systemic change, not just putting in performative policies, but things that are actually leading to these changes.
Yeah, I'd also like to mention that, is this working? Yeah. On neurodivergent masking / passing and the impact on mental health, I think this is a really important topic. For many years, I had to hide my mental illness. It was a huge amount of effort and a huge amount of stress, which simply made managing my mental illness more difficult. I wrote my memoir, The Center Cannot Hold, My Journey Through Mental Illness, after I had tenure. It was a huge relief no longer having to mask my mental illness, but it's important to understand that I kept my mask on until I felt safe to take it off. A lot of times students ask me whether they should come out to prospective employers. I wish there were a simple answer. There isn't. As a society, we're just not there yet. So masking and passing as normal are very much live issues. And that's what makes panels like ours today so very important.
Thank you, Ellen. I think if Olga and Sneha, if you have anything to add about this, about masking and sort of what you've found in your work and what it says just about the prerequisites for belonging in our world, and kind of piggybacks on what you're all talking about also in terms of neurodiversity affirming practices and how can we practice these in many different spaces to hopefully reduce the need for masking and create a more inclusive, better sense of belonging for all people.
I think traditionally, in ABA, one of the criticisms of ABA is that a goal is to make our clients indistinguishable from their peers. And that kind of sums up masking, right? Is you're asking someone to not engage in the behaviors that help soothe them, help regulate them, help them get through the day-to-day of life. And that's unacceptable. Dr. Jonathan Tarbox here at USC, myself, as well as a neurodivergent colleague, we actually just published a paper on neurodiversity affirming practices within ABA, applied behavior analysis, which is a very commonly used intervention for autistic folks. And I think that it's, like we've been talking about this entire panel, it is so important to listen to the criticism sometimes levied against our field or our work and take those to heart and then improve our practices. In the research that I've come across, there's a huge toll on a person's mental health when they have to engage in masking all the time. They have to hide their natural behaviors in order to fit into a society that defines differences as deficits. You know, there's increased rates of suicidality, there's burnout, exhaustion, there's just, we're adding more harm than good when we're encouraging masking types of behaviors.
I would bring up one other point, which was that I was very honored to get a MacArthur quote genius grant, and my school gave me a T-shirt, and it had a picture of Einstein, and a picture of me, and it said only one of us is a certified genius, and I thought, I've been certified many times in the past, but never in this way.
You know, in there has been kind of like a somewhat accepted, although problematic, kind of quote-unquote fact that in autism, the prevalence of girls to boys is 4-1. And people used to never question this. And even though there is really no, well, Simon Baron Cohen had some ideas about why that would be, but I don't know about that. But anyway, the point is that nobody really figured out why that would be or how. And I think that lately there is more and more research on women, you know, girls and women with autism. And, you know, going back to the masking question, and that they are incredibly, enormously good at masking. And for me, as a kind of linguist and a person who is interested in social interaction, the idea that that, you know, girls, you know, and women with autism are so good at masking basically shows that, first of all, they're aware of what the neuronormative behavior is, because otherwise you can't really mask if you don't know what it is that you're supposed to be doing, right? And secondly, the research on the mental health consequences of that shows that it comes at an enormous psychological price of stress and anxiety and never feeling like kind of at home in the world kind of thing. And but, you know, and Amber Angel, who actually works with Lindsay, who is my former student, we just published a paper in the journal Autism on girls and the whole kind of healthcare situation, you know, what kind of healthcare girls get versus boys. And there are differences, and they're very important to understand, you know, how that masking also comes across in healthcare, you know, what consequences that has in healthcare, because, you know, it's a very, very practically complicated issue, you know, that it's not just, yes, you know, somebody is kind of good at passing as a neuronormative person, but also what it does and what consequences it has. And some of these consequences are very harmful.
And if you actually look at the history of autism as a diagnostic criteria, the primary folks who were being diagnosed were white boys. And so the girls at that time were labeled with the same behaviors as hysteria or other things like that. And so even now you can see the impact of that both culturally and with gender. The rates of diagnosis is higher with white boys than with white girls or black boys. There's other diagnoses that people of other cultural backgrounds get instead of autism. And so this again goes back to the environment and the social model of disability and the impacts that society has at a time in understanding different behaviors.
Yeah, thank you all so much. I'm told we have to stop here. I'm sure we could all listen for a lot longer. But thank you so much for sharing your perspectives and sharing your expertise with us. And as a reminder to everybody, the panelists will all be upstairs, I believe. Yeah, upstairs in the kind of common area. So they'll be there to sign books, also answer questions and chat with you all. So thank you all so much for coming. And thanks again to the panelists.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast and visit us at podcasts.usc.edu.